So yesterday, the another working institution which I was discussing with you all is the office of the president. We also talked about how the president of India gets elected, who is supposed to become the president, what are the qualifications to be appointed as the president of India, and the powers and functions of the President of India. Everything is in the name of the President of India. He is the nominal head. He works according to the advice which has been given by the Council of Ministers, and on the advice of the Council of Ministers, the President of India carries out its duties and functions. Just categorize the powers of the President of India on the basis of executive power, legislative power, and judicial power. In the executive power, all the appointments are done in the name of the President of India. It's the President who appoints the Chief Justice, the members of the Planning Commission, the Election Commission of India, and the other two election commissioners. All such appointments are done by him. He is the commander-in-chief. He is the head of the three defense forces. All the greater rank at the Air Force, Navy, or the Army, the commander-in-chief, everybody gets elected by the president. Coming to the legislative power, whenever the bill is to be passed, when a bill is passed, it gets the recommendation of the president. Only on the consent of the President of India, only on the consent of the President of India, any sort of bill gets passed. Either it is the money bill or an ordinary bill. Everything has to get the consent. All the types of issues, policy making, decision making, or any sort of a thing that has to be consented by the President of India. Judicial power. He appoints the Chief Justice of India, the judges of the Supreme Court, and the High Courts as well. He gives the oath of office to the Chief Justice of India. Now, yesterday we talked about the powers and functions, and I was talking about one of the discretionary powers. What is that discretionary power? Discretionary powers means the power which are self-made and which is only in the hand of the president. That is the discretion of any particular working institution. So talking about the discretionary power of the President of India, when after the general election, in order to form the government, whose government is going to govern the country, the majority party member who has got the majority of seats, and if he has achieved the two-third majority, only then he will be declared to be the governing the country. And that is the power given to the president. When he sees that a leading party has got the majority, he asks them to show the confidence, and after showing the confidence, the leader of the majority party is elected as a prime minister. It's a simple thing. Now, suppose for any instance, ki none of the single party gets the majority. That means to form the government, it is necessary to get 281 seats in the parliament, securing the two-third majority. And if any of the leading majority party, suppose for instance is lagging, that particular party is lagging in 7 seats, yani 7 seats kam hai majorities. In that circumstance, what will happen? It is the discretion of the President of India at that time that he may call that party to produce its majority at the floor of the house, giving them a stipulated period of time. एक समय अवधि दे दिया जाता है कि within a particular time you show your majority. Although that party is lagging in 7 seats, so during that time, the time span which is being given to them, during that time the same party is trying to secure the majority by trying to get the support of any of the members, या whoever are the independent members, या whichever member wants to come in the party of that majority party. So anyhow or the other, if he secures the majority, that party will govern the country. He will be appointed as the leader of that party, will be appointed as the prime minister, and that party will govern the country. So this is the discretionary power in the hands of the president, that if none of the party secures a majority, it is the discretion of the president that he or she may call that particular party who has got the majority, not 2/3, but at least a majority in the parliament, to show the confidence in the house within a particular period of a time. And if that happens so, then he or she will be regarded to be the prime minister, and the same party will govern the country. Now this was the office of the president of India. Coming to the last portion, that is the judicial body. We talked about the executive, we talked about the legislative, and the third organ of the working of the institution, which is very much important, and that is the judiciary. The apex body of the judicial system in our country, that is the Supreme Court. Supreme Court at the center, that is at Delhi. And besides Supreme Court, there are various other high courts in India. Probably every state have got their own high courts. And all the districts have their own civil courts, that is the district courts. These are the layers of the judicial system in our country. So, talking about the judiciary, we have to just recall back, and I would like you to go to the thing, ki let us return one final time in the story of office memorandum that we started. This time, let us not recall the story, but imagine how different the story could have been. Remember, the story came to a satisfactory end because the Supreme Court gave a verdict that was accepted by everyone. Let us take for example the very first thing which we talked about, the office memorandum. There was heaves and tussles, there were commotions within the people, the cases were filed in the Supreme Court and the high courts, which was basically considered, and it was piled up, and Supreme Court gave a verdict on that Mandal Commission report that only remove away the creamy layer, that is whoever, it was not meant for each and all OBC members. Supreme Court gave the verdict, just modifying some of the part, that whoever are coming within the creamy layer of OBC, those persons shall not be given the privilege of this reservation. And only after that verdict, everybody honored that thing. That means what? We see that the judicial system in our country, that is a paradox. That is the most respectable institution which is honored by one and all. And same was the case with the office memorandum also. The moment the Supreme Court gave its verdict, that was taken into satisfaction by one and all. What would have happened in the following situation? Suppose if Supreme Court would not have interfered into that matter, then probably some type of questions might have arose at that time. It would be, if there was nothing like a Supreme Court in the country, take for example, if we did not have the Supreme Court, even if there was a Supreme Court, if it had no power to judge actions of the government, another question, even if we had the Supreme Court, but if there would be a system, if there would be a law that the Supreme Court will not decide anything against the government, then what would happen? Tab ye samasya kya ho sakta? Then the third question is that, Even if it had the power, if no one trusted the Supreme Court to give a fair verdict, even if Supreme Court had the power to interfere into the matter of the government decision, then another question might have crept up. Then how the people would have trusted the order given by the Supreme Court is fair or not? That is also one of the questions which might have arose. Another question, even if it gave a fair judgment, if those who appealed against the government order did not accept the judgment, even if Supreme Court interfered into the matter and people did not obey to that judgment, what would happen? So several type of cases are there, several type of questions arise, that even if there would be Supreme Court, even if Supreme Court would have been there, did it have the power to decide the matter relating to the government decision? Even if it related to the government decision also, whether Supreme Court's verdict, whether the Supreme Court's judgment was fair for each and all, whether it was to be trusted by one and all. So several type of questions creep up. That is why we see that in India, our judicial system, the judiciary is absolutely free from the interaction of executive and legislature. That is why we say that judiciary is absolutely free from executive and legislature. All the courts at different levels in a country put together are called the judiciary. All the courts, either it is at the district level, or at the state level, they are the high courts, or at the central level, that most paradox, that is the Supreme Court. The entire chain, that is called the judicial system. That, a basic simple word for that would be judiciary. The Indian judiciary consists of the Supreme Court for the entire nation, high courts for the states, and district courts at each and every district of the country. It means the Supreme Court controls the judicial administration in the country. Its decisions are binding on all other courts of the country, and it tries to take up the matter of certain disputes. So the Supreme Court in India, that acts as a watchdog. Whenever any type of a dispute takes place, whenever any type of an interference by one government or the state, by two states or one simple government, or the state government or the central government, whenever there happens to be any dispute, it is the Supreme Court which will interfere into that and solve such type of issues. What type of disputes are being solved by the Supreme Court? It includes the cases relating to between citizens of the country. Whenever one citizen and another citizen, there is a dispute between the two, so the Supreme Court decides the matter. Secondly, it also decides the matter relating to between the citizen and the government, between the government on the one side and the citizen on the second side. It decides matter relating to citizens and on the other side, the citizens too. Secondly, it decides matter relating to citizens and the government. And the third one, between two or more state governments. Between two or more state governments. Such matters are also decided by the Supreme Court. Between the government and the union and the state government. Between the governments at the union and the state level. And when there happens to be any type of a dispute between the central government and the state government, that will be decided by the Supreme Court. Whenever there is any type of a dispute relating to the government and the state level, that will be decided. Between the government and the citizen, that will be decided by the Supreme Court. Between two citizens, that shall be decided by the Supreme Court. So, all such type of a disputes will be decided by the Supreme Court, and the verdict shall be obeyed by one and all. Independence of judiciary. What does it mean? Independence of judiciary means the judicial system is such a system in a country in which there is no interference. There is no interference of the executive and the legislative body. Means in the working of the judicial system of the country, there shall not be any whisper or any type of a control made by the executive body or the legislative body. Judicial system is absolutely free in pronouncing any type of a judgment without the interference of the executive and the legislative. Independence of the judiciary means that it is not under the control of the legislator or the executive. The judges do not act on the direction of the government according to the wishes of the party in power. Means the judicial system shall not be ever threatened by the government. The government means what? The ruling party who are ruling the country. Means it shall not work according to the direction of the government. The judicial system is absolutely free in giving its any type of a pronouncement of any judgment. It shall not be controlled by that ruling party. That is why all the modern democracies of the world have courts that have the independent, that are independent of the legislature and the executive. So, looking into the democratic situation or the democracies of the world, we find that the judicial system in the country that is not guided by the executive and the legislature. It is the judiciary which every time remains free at that time. There shall not be control. There shall not be any control made by the executive or the legislature upon the judicial system. The judges of the Supreme Court and the High Courts are appointed by the President on the advice of the Prime Minister and consolidation with the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court and the consultation with the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The judges of the Supreme Court and the High Courts, they are appointed by the President. And how does the President appoint them? The President appoints them on the advice given by the Council of Ministers and the Prime Minister. And with the consultation of the Chief Justice of India, the judges of the High Courts and the Supreme Courts, they get elected. In practice, it now means that the senior judges of the Supreme Court select the new judges of the Supreme Court and the High Courts. It means the senior judges, they get... I was discussing that the judges of the Supreme Court and the High Courts, they get elected by the President on the advice of the Council of Ministers with the consultation of the Chief Justice of the country. Once a person is appointed as the judge of the Supreme Court or the High Court, it is nearly impossible to remove him or her from that position. That system is known as the impeachment. Once a person gets appointed as the judge of the Supreme Court or the High Court, it becomes very difficult to remove them. And there is a system by which the President of the country as well as the judges of the Supreme Court or the Chief Justice of the country, they can get removed. And that system is known as the impeachment motion. Now your people will ask, sir, what is this impeachment motion? Impeachment motion means if any person, either is the judge or the Chief Justice or the President of India, if he or she is seen to practice in an unfair manner, is not doing the duty according to the provisions of the Constitution, which is something illegal, then the matter shall be discussed in the Parliament, in the Lok Sabha, as well as the Rajya Sabha. And that has to get the support of the 2/3 of the majority. And after getting the 2/3 majority support in the Parliament, that impeachment process shall be drawn against the judges of the Supreme Court or the High Court or the President of India, it can be also. So, and that impeachment motion shall be followed up by the support of the 2/3 majority of the Parliament. And if 2/3 majority is attained, then that particular judge or the Chief Justice or the President of India shall be removed. But till today's date, after getting the 70 years of independence, no such type of a system has been taken up. If it is found also, that some of the judges or the president of India or the chief justice of India gets intermingled in some of the illegal acts, then what happens? The same person is being made to resign from the post, keeping into the respect about the democracy of the country. So they are made to resign. So till now we have seen that no such type of a impeachment motion against any of the judges of the country have taken place till yet. So it is difficult to remove them. A judge can be removed only by an impeachment motion passed separately by two-third members. Passed separately by the two-third members of the Houses of the Parliament. It has never happened in the history of the Indian democracy, which I discussed. The judiciary in India is also one of the powerful in the world. The Supreme Court and the High Courts have the power to interpret the constitution of the country. It is the Supreme Court and the High Court which has got the power to interpret the constitution. Interpreting the constitution means whatever things are written in the constitution, the actual interpretation, the meaning of that particular thing can be done by the Supreme Court and the High Court. It is the power given to the Supreme Court for the interpretation of any law that is in the hands of the Supreme Court and the High Courts. They can declare any law to be null and invalid. Kisi bhi law ko null and void declare karne ka power kiske haath mein hai? That is in the hands of the Supreme Court and the High Courts. They can declare invalid any law of the legislature or the actions of the executive. If any action of the executive or if any working of the legislature that is not according to the provisions of the law, then the Supreme Court or the High Court can interfere into that matter. And after when it can interfere into the matter, what happens? After it interfere into the matter, it can declare that thing, work of that executive or the legislature as invalid. Thus, we can see that it is the Supreme Court or the High Court that can determine the constitutional validity of the legislation or action of the executive of the country. So, either it is the action of the executive or the working done by the legislature, the constitutional validity of that working or the process made by the legislature, that shall be determined by the Supreme Court and the High Court. And if the Supreme Court and the High Court thinks that such a type of a working of the legislature or the executive is not according to the work, is not according to the justification, then it can make or treat that work to be invalid or illegal. This is known as the judiciary. Now, a very important thing, kya kisi bhi the work which is being made. So, treating any action of the executive or the work done by the legislature, and if it is treated to be not according to the law, then the Supreme Court can declare that law to be illegal. This is called the judiciary, the most important power of the judiciary, that is the Supreme Court and the High Court. It has got the power to interpret the constitution. It can declare the work of the legislature or any action of the executive as illegal if it contravenes, if it goes against the law, then the Supreme Court can declare it to be illegal. So this is the judicial review. The Supreme Court of India has also ruled that the core of base principle of constitution cannot be changed by the parliament. It is also to be said, taken into consideration that the lawmakers sit down in the parliament and they make the law. Any modification or any type of an amendment that can be taken up in the parliament. And the moment it gets the support of the two-thirds, so that gets amended or modified. But the Supreme Court has interpreted in one of the things that the core basic element of the constitution ka jo basic elements jo hai, that cannot be changed by the parliament also. So there are some of the basic elements, like talking about the secularism, talking about socialist, secular, democratic, republic, justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, and such type of things, which are the basic core things of the preamble or the constitution that cannot be changed by the parliament. The powers and the independence of the Indian judiciary allows it to act as the guardian of the fundamental rights. Because judiciary has been given the power of maintaining the law and order and to act as a watchdog if there happens to be any sort of a dispute. So, looking into all such aspects and seeing that judiciary shall not be affected by the executive and the legislature, so it is also saying that the maintenance or the guardian of the fundamental right is the Supreme Court and the High Courts. We shall see in the other chapter also that in case of any violation of their rights, the Supreme Court interferes into that. If any of the rights of a person, there are six fundamental rights guaranteed by the Constitution, and if any of the fundamental right gets violated, then the Supreme Court can interfere into the matter, or a person can knock the door of the judiciary by way of filing the writs, and by way of filing the writs, the Supreme Court shall hear into the matter, and after hearing into the matter, may pronounce the judgment. So, regarding the maintenance of fundamental rights, it is the Supreme Court and the High Courts which has got the power in that. And those power are called the writ, power of writs. So, whenever any type of a hindrance of rights take place, then the simple individual or the states, they can go and knock the door of the judiciary to get and their grievances settled. In recent years, the courts have been given several judgment and directions to protect public interest in the human rights. We have seen that courts have been given the several interests and the powers to that. And one can approach the courts if public interest is hurt by the actions of the government. And if the public action is violated by the government, then if public action is violated by the government, then such persons can interfere into the matter and move to the Supreme Courts, and Supreme Court the matter will be settled. So, to sum up, we have finished the portion of the working of the institution. We talked about the judicial system. We talked about the office of the President of the country. We also talked about the office of the Prime Minister, the powers and function, the working of the Parliament, what comprises the Parliament, which is the elderly body, which is the lower body, and then we also talked about how the working in the Parliament take place, who are the permanent executive, who are the non-permanent executive. Then we also discussed the Mandal Commission report, how executive executed the law, how did the legislature legislated the law, and how did judiciary interfere into the matter, and matter got settled up. So, we have discussed all type of things here, and if there will be any problem, then you can ask me anytime. Till then, goodbye.